Good morning and welcome to this St. Michael's on this wonderfully balmy winter morning. It's good to be here. We begin with an acknowledgement of country. We meet on the land of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, land that was taken from them without their consent, treaty or compensation. We acknowledge the Wurundjeri elders, past and present, and Wurundjeri young people who hold the hope for justice for the people and for the land. Please be seated. Today is the beginning of NAIDOC Week, and we light this candle in solidarity and in memory of our First Nations brothers and sisters, and the acknowledgement of their commitment to the land, to the sea, and to the air. Wherever you are on your spiritual journey, wherever you've come from, wherever you're going to, whatever you believe, whatever you do not believe, you're welcome. Today this service is recorded. It will be edited and uploaded later this afternoon. And to any visitors and newcomers, you're very welcome. And just a reminder about mobile phones. If you've got it with you, please turn it to silent. Thank you. I had to remind myself to turn mine on to silent, so yep, it's not here. Today's theme. Today I've chosen the theme from me to you to us. I acknowledge the importance of me, but we do not completely exist as individuals. Others impact on us and we impact on others. That is the you. The us is a collective. We have the potential to go beyond, focusing on the differences that exist and explore with curiosity the aspects of us that coexist. And this is not necessarily limited to human relationships, but how we and the earth also relate to each other. Creator of the universe, you made the world in beauty and restored all things in glory. We pray that wherever your image is still disfigured by poverty, sickness, selfishness, war, and greed, the new creation in Jesus Christ may appear in justice, love, and peace. For this we pray. Amen. And our first hymn is Now Thank We All Our God. us pray. God, we pray you open our hearts to your power, moving around us and between us and within us, until your glory is revealed in your love of both friend and enemy, in communities transformed by justice and compassion, and in the healing of all that is broken. Amen. Remembering Jesus, we pray together. Gracious Spirit, who loves us like a mother, whose realm is blooming among us. May the peace of divine presence be with you. Let us share a sign of peace. Sorry, I was just going for a bit of a walk. And thank you.
The Hebrew Bible reading is from Psalm 123. To you I lift up my eyes, O you who are enthroned in the heavens. As the eyes of servants look to the hand of their master, as the eyes of a maid to the hand of her mistress, so our eyes look to the Lord our God, until he has mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, O Lord, have mercy upon us, for we have had more than enough of contempt. Our soul has had more than its fill of the scorn of those who are at ease, of the contempt of the proud. For wisdom that was in the beginning. The Gospel reading is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6, verses 1 to 13. He left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offence at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honour except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. For wisdom that invites and inspires, we give thanks. The contemporary reading is The Tower by Jeremy Palmer. I sat in my tower thinking the worst of humanity, spouting philosophy compulsively, clever things that talked but couldn't warm me. She entered. She made it past my cleverness and stubbornness. Steel bolts on doors melted in her touch. She found me, malnourished and cowered in the corner. I found her. I recognised the water in her eyes. They were wells in the desert. I knew that she spoke for my soul. Whoever she is, I trade my tower for the chance to walk beside her, my kingdom for the chance to lay my forehead at her feet. To live beside her, die beside her, in the way like candle wax, embracing, to lay within her garden, to close my eyes and know this poverty is sweet. For wisdom embodied among us, we give thanks.
Amen.
What struck me in today's readings was Psalm 123, verse 4. Our soul has had more than its fill of the scorn of those who are at ease, of the contempt of the proud. Our soul has had more than its fill. That's what grabbed my attention. Yes, I'm tired of the sanctity of the pious, the arrogant, the people who have it all together, the social influences, the people who have all the answers for every question and everyone else, and those people who look down with scorn upon us mere mortals, who are engaged fully in the daily struggle of making meaning of life and just trying to live. The scorn of those who are at ease seems to fit my initial reaction and contempt of the proud. Also appears to fit with my initial thinking. The verse seems to reinforce the divide between them and us, the haves and the have-nots, the privileged and the poor. And like all things now, I start to think about the times when I have felt my soul has been more than its fill of the scorn of those who are at ease. And then I catch myself. I catch myself thinking of the times and occasions when I have placed myself above another and others. And I am ashamed. Sarah and I were in the Darwin Botanical Gardens and I read this poem. It's titled Hearts Broken. Mothers left with empty arms, hearts broken, minds with no clams, children without an identity taken from their country. For such was the policy, a strong destructive force. For the government's command, deny them access to culture and land. Tears fell in empty arms as they sat in silence, waiting and hoping in vain for the children they could not claim. They were the silent victims. Aboriginal mothers of yesterday. So children of the stolen generation, remember them today. On the other side of this stone was a plaque quoting extracts from Prime Minister Paul Keating's speech of the 10th of December 1992. Which he presented at the launch of the International Year of the World's Indigenous People. He's quoted as saying, "It begins, I think, with that act of recognition. Recognition that it was we that did the dispossessing. We took the children from their mothers. We failed to ask, how would I feel if this were done to me?" Today, we're remembering the covenanting statement that was presented 30 years ago at the 7th Uniting Church in Australia Assembly. On July 10th, 1994. The covenanting statement was the result of the 5th Assembly, May 1988, where Reverend Charles Harris and Reverend Dr. Dijinyini Kondara called for a covenant to bind the Uniting Church with the Uniting Aboriginal and Islander Christian Congress. 6 years later, the President of the Uniting Church, Dr. Jill Tabart, and the chairperson of the Uniting Aboriginal and Islander Christian Congress, Pastor Bill Hollingsworth, presented the Covenant Statement. I'm going to share with us all a couple of extracts from this significant document. Firstly, Jill. But on the other hand, we who are non-Aboriginal members of our church grieve with you, our Aboriginal and Islander brothers and sisters. We grieve that the way in which our people often brought the gospel to your people belittled and harmed much of your culture and confused the gospel with Western ways. As a result, you and we are the poorer, and the image of God in us all is twisted and blurred, and we are not what God meant us to be. We lament that our people took your land from you as if it were land belonging to nobody, and often responded with great violence to the resistance of your people. Our people took from you your means of livelihood and desecrated many sacred places. Our justice system discriminated against you, and the high incarceration rate of your people and the number of black deaths in custody show that the denial of justice continues today. Bill wrote, your ancestors came to us in different ways, and we saw little of our caring God in them. They did not come to us as God's will would dictate, but dispossess us, take our children, rape our women, kill our men and boys and destroy our culture, reject our values and beliefs, and ultimately claim our lands as their own. As a direct result of this violent dispossession, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people have lived as strangers and outcasts in their own land. It is difficult for us again to recall the atrocities of the past and agree to walk towards you and offer forgiveness, because many of our people feel your position of influence in our present society reminds us of who committed these great offences. Today, we remember and acknowledge that covenant. Today also, as stated earlier, begins the beginning of NAIDOC Week. So far today, I've had a singular focus: the fractured relationship between Australia's First Nations peoples and the people who have immigrated to Australia since 1788. Turn now to Jeremy's poem, The Tower. Sorry, I'd turned my phone off, but I hadn't turned the watch off. I'm deeply sorry about that. Turn to Jeremy's poem, The Tower. And verse 3 in particular. She found me, malnourished and cowered in the corner. I found her. I recognised the water in her eyes. There were wells in the desert. I knew that she spoke for my soul. In the context of today, I'm suggesting that she is God. She found us in the corner. We are malnourished and cowered in the corner, for we cannot readily identify a solution to the cultural divide that exists between First and Second Nations peoples. The photo of the underside of the pier is a depiction of the relationship between peoples, for it is complex and confusing. However, because of the differing number of individual parts, there is the possibility of acknowledging the purpose of each part and then joining them together to form a functioning whole, in this instance, a pier. We as individuals have many parts that make up who we are. There is our personality, our genetics, our environment, and then the differing components of our physical bodies. We are a complex construction that is evolving and continually emerging. So to understand the me, I have to give me time and space, and also the permission that I may never fully know and understand who I am, other than the words that hold the complex and sometimes contradictory natures of who I am. I also am a social being who interacts and engages with other complex and contradictory beings. And then there are the interactions we have with the physical environment, which is of itself warm and inviting, cold and harsh, in need of care and respect. But I'll limit this reflection to the interactions within and between people and address the environment maybe at a later time. Martin Buber wrote a little book, I and Thou. Martin Buber was a philosopher who taught at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem from 1938 to 1951. His proposition is that we have three basic forms of relationship. They are I it, I you, I thou. The I it relationship is where the individual relates to others as material objects, incapable of possessing any qualities worthy of engagement other than to satisfy the needs of the individual I. The I-it relationship is one of taking. The I-you relationship is where the individual engages with the other as another you, where the other is more than an object, can be a subject but not quite equal with the I. And then there are equal relationships where the I and the you relate to each other equally. Here, the relationship is not transactional. Whereas the I-thou relationship is where the I relates to God and also sees within the other I the divine. In the I-thou relationship, the divine is seen and acknowledged within the other, and as both parties to the relationship engage as equals, who recognise and celebrate not only their equality, but the divinity within each of the other. It is the I-thou relationship that dismantles barriers of difference, for it focuses on that which unites in the relationship and is common amongst the people. The relationship is based on mutuality, not on division. The I-thou relationship is the movement to us in the statement moving from me to you to us. Moving from me to you to us is the necessary pathway for healing within our relationships, within our community, within our country, within our world. The movement requires curiosity and acceptance. It does not require us all to be the same, but requires us to see the differences not as barriers to relationship, but pathways to understanding and broadening of horizons. As we've seen, Our history is littered with injustice, abuse, violence, and intolerance. But our future need not be held captive to the past. For as we recognise the power and significance of the covenant, we move to recognising the importance of and the necessity to see beyond the me and engage with the you, the other, and embrace fully us. In so doing, we have the potential to bring healing to our relationships both individually and corporately. An outcome of this is to bring healing to our land. We are offered the opportunity to live fully in engaging ourselves, our communities, and our faith. In this way, we move from me to you to us. Amen. The next hymn is Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. Let us pray. God, we offer you our prayers on behalf of the universe in which we are privileged to live and our neighbours with whom we share it. Open our hearts to your power moving around us and between us and within us. pray that communities will be transformed by justice and compassion and in the healing of all that is broken. In silence, we pray for the needs of our world, for those we know and love, and for ourselves. These are our prayers for our earth and its peoples. Holy Spirit, in us and with us. Amen. In our Sunday gathering, we dedicate in prayer gifts given both online and within the church, shared to sustain our common life. Together. Compassionate One, with these offerings we also bring our anxieties and uncertainties and cynicism born of pain. Meet us in our vulnerability. Ground our faith in the connection that we may rise as a community to the calling of these days. Amen. Thank you. Sacrament of Communion is offered for people present at church and for people who join us online. Gathered and apart, we are the body of Christ. Today in the church, communion is served at the front for people who are able to come forward. Ushers will indicate when it is time for you or for your row to come forward and which aisle to use when returning. If you are not comfortable in negotiating the steps and the ramps, roving service will offer communion to people remaining in their seats. to receive the bread. Cup your hand so servers can drop it into your hand in a non-contact way, and take the glass yourself from the wine tray. Take it back to your seat and drink. Or drink it at the time you're served, placing your empty glass on the one of the clear bowls. Bread is gluten-free and the wine is unfermented grape juice. St Michael's Uniting Church is an open community and all are invited to the table. Whatever you believe or do not believe about communion, you are welcome to participate in this sacred meal, which is for all people. The peace of God be with you and also with you. In the presence of the living God, we lift our hearts in joy and give thanks. Let us give thanks for the continuity of the universe, for the sun rising day by day and the moon rising night by night, for all the life with which we share this planet, for all the interactions and connections that bind us to it, and the elements of which all are composed. Let us give thanks and seek to live in harmony with us. Let us give thanks for the flow of human history, for the events that have shaped and moulded us, and all our sisters and brothers, our siblings, for the ones who question that history, for the ones who unearth the stories of the vanquished, the oppressed, and the vanquished, the oppressed, the forgotten, and the unrecorded. Let us give thanks and take our place in the ministry, struggling for the community. Let us give thanks to the ones who have provided inspiration and hope, for prophets and martyrs and poets, thinkers and preachers and healers, for the ones who have linked thought and action, for reformers and rebels and protesters. Let us give thanks. Join with them in quest for justice. Let us give thanks for all who have revealed or discovered deep and lasting truths. Let us celebrate their lives and deaths, their thoughts and writings, their continuing witness in the world today. Let us give thanks. Share in spreading the prophetic justice. Today we give thanks for Jesus of Nazareth, in whom Christians believe that God was especially present, one of the channels through which God as made known to humanity. On the night that he was betrayed, he feasted with his followers. He took bread, gave thanks, and broke it. And gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He took a cup of wine, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For all that Jesus of Nazareth means to us, we give thanks. So today, we share bread and wine together as a sign that we are one humanity, as a pledge that we will work for justice, as a foretaste of that which can be despite what is and what has been. May the Spirit that guides us all be present in this feast, taking this bread and this wine, the concerns that we have expressed, the lives that we lead, and transforming them all for the unity of all creation in service of love. God, whose body is all creation, may we come to know you in all the earth and feel you in our blood, so will no part of us or the world be lost to your transform. Thanks be to God. Say all who worship in spirit and truth. Thanks be to God. Bread of life broken for you. The cup of blessing poured out for you. Gifts of earth, gifts of spirit. Christ made known among us. The bread of life. Amen. The cup of blessing. Let us pray together. Holy source of life and love, with all that we are, we thank you. You share with us the gifts of life. We go now to live your love and to seek your liberation and peace for all creation. Maker, star giver. God in Jesus, storyteller. God the Holy Spirit, traveller. God of all our days and nights. Go now with the love of God enfolding you, the peace of the risen one within you, and the breath of the Holy Spirit inspiring your life.